research experience for undergrad students has two goals. It has the goal, first of all, in education. If I show a 10-year-old a three-dimensional imagery of a galaxy merger, I may actually entice this person to come into or be interested into science. This is one application. The other application is to get undergraduate students who are not primarily interested in master's degrees or PhD degrees to actually get them interested in it. Because the environment which we create for the student is roughly the same what you would have if you run a PhD program. Students come in, you propose a research question, they divide up into teams, you meet with them every week or so, at least they have to give a presentation what they're doing, and you can't make somebody think, you can just propose a question.
I'm CORY, I'm a computer engineering student in the Kate Gleason College of Engineering, and I'm from North Carolina. We're addressing the problem of exploring 3D environments using a virtual camera. So we've been working on a product that will actually allow you to explore a 3D world using a 3D medium, such as like the iPad.
At the beginning, we just created or tried to create imagery. Later on, it became apparent it's one thing to create an image, but how it's perceived is actually a significantly more important question.
A lot of the pictures that you see for universes and galaxies, they're mostly computer generated from and combined from different things that telescopes see. A lot of the colors aren't there, and it's a flat 2D image. So using this, you will actually be able to go around the image and actually see things that you wouldn't be able to see on the 2D image, because you'll actually be able to get behind it, and there might be something behind that image that you would have never knew were there.
The 3D extension is just natural because space is three-dimensional, and our next step will actually be to go to real 3D movies like you see at the IMAX theater, Avatar equivalent. It's significantly more complicated to create these imagery, but this will immerse you into a complete three-dimensional area. And then if you have the iPad for control what you see, this is at least, I hope so, the best user interface I can get to one of these virtual worlds.
It's like having somebody play a video game for the first time. They look at the controller, first they're trying to figure out how to actually hold it. But with an iPad, it's just simply point and shoot. You look left, look right, look up and down.
If we would develop a visualization environment with this iPad looking around, just for the sake of computer science, we would not get anywhere. It's like you have a copier, but nothing to copy. So in our case, we work with astrophysicists, and our system actually will be used and is used to create visuals for them. This interdisciplinary aspect is very, very important.
Working here with Hans-Peter has made me a lot more independent as a student. He comes in here, he tells you what you need to do, and then from there on, it's you. You and your group, and you have to do what you have to do in order to figure out that problem and get to that plateau for the week.
The problem has to be big enough. On the other hand side, it has to be doable. And for students who are like CORY in his second year, it is you can't expect from a second, third year student to do research on a PhD level. But three students working on something allows us to create publishable papers. And so far we have 6 papers published. So from an output point of view, from a research output point of view, that's extremely successful.
I'm Danielle BURNASH. I received my bachelor's degree in psychology here at the Rochester Institute of Technology. I am now a master's student at the University of Rochester, receiving a degree in school and community counseling. I had to pick a topic to research for my senior project, and I felt because we're so immersed in the deaf community here and I had deaf friends and there's deaf professors, that I really wanted to do something related with the deaf community here. So I collaborated with Lindsay and we decided to look into some maltreatment aspect of deaf children. Upwards of 97% of deaf children have hearing parents, so I thought there's a language communication barrier there that must play a role in, you know, the attachment that they form with their families. I was really surprised, actually, going into this research to learn how many parents of deaf students here at RIT didn't know sign language.
these parents aren't signing, how are they communicating with their children? And what impact does that have on the relationship between parent and child and risk for maltreatment? Well, we were very surprised when we analyzed the data. When we sat down and started looking at the numbers, literally we almost fell off our chairs. What we found is roughly 77% of deaf and hard of hearing college students reported some kind of child victimization.
We continued to collect data, which made my sample a lot larger, and so I had kind of a fresh research to present at the Association for Cognitive Behavioral Therapies in San Francisco in November of 2010, and it was overwhelming and amazing all at the same time. The amount of people that were there, the doctors, the doctorate students, and I was like this little undergrad there with my research, and it really held its own. It was, the quality was right up there with all the other doctorate students, and it was very satisfying, and I was very happy with it.
The poster got a lot of attention, and we had a lot of people coming by, and every time they would come by and I'd say, oh, Danielle's my undergraduate student, I would always get the same reaction, like, wow, that's fantastic. I can't believe undergraduates are doing that kind of research.
I definitely fed off of her energy from probably the first class I ever had with her when I first started here at RIT. And I realized that it's not a grueling, cumbersome, you know, heavy load project. It just was interesting, and you know, it didn't seem like work to me, and I was like, wow, this is research. So now I'm like a research junkie, and this research will continue here at RIT for me.
Hi, my name is Delilah Bowman. I'm a sophomore, and my major is packaging science.
My name is Camilla Pierre. I am a sophomore here at RIT, and my major is mechanical engineering technology. The title of our research project is Occupancy and Integrated Systems, and what we're trying to do is basically integrate two systems, the web control and on guard. And what that will do is basically use the full capabilities. So when we integrate these systems, you'll be able to do more than just record what's going on in the building.
We already have cameras in the building that we're working on. We already have a Linnell system, and we already have an HVAC system that heats and cools the building. But when we integrate these two systems, the cameras will not only be able to record what people are doing, they will also be able to actually see and say, hey, this person is leaving this room now. So that means that we can turn off the lights, stop cooling or stop heating this room to save energy and cost.
Financial aid wants to know the flow of traffic in the building, because a lot of people enter and leave the building, but what they would like to know, how many of those people come to them instead of the innovation center. So with our integrated systems, the camera will be able to detect the direction that the people go. This project is very important to Linnell, actually, because it will help them to start somewhere small and end somewhere big with this, because integrated systems, I think, can be something that will be used widely.
When this project is actually done, we can take it and use it in real life, not just in this lab, but in the financial services building, also maybe in shopping malls, airports. 5 or 10 years down the road, we are hoping that the outcomes from the project will reduce the energy being used throughout the world, reduce costs for companies and this school in particular, and also enhance security. Working on this project, when Dr. Garrick wasn't available, he had to put his trust in the students and know that we were gonna come in and do what we have to do. Yes, it was maybe a little stressful, and we had some pressure put upon us, but the pressure was a good thing because it pushed us to do what we had to do.
Not many of my other freshman friends that attend other universities have the opportunity that I had When I told them that, oh, I'm doing research here at RIT, they were surprised because not many freshmen, like I said, have this opportunity, so it has been great. RIT is a great school, it has been great doing this.
We work with a lot of undergraduates here at RIT, and we're lucky to have a lot of terrific undergraduates who do actually more research than many graduate students do at other institutions. Our undergraduates are publishing, they're presenting research at national conferences, they're gaining a lot of recognition, and they're learning and doing a lot, and I think it's preparing them well for graduate school.
From an educational point of view, I think the goals have not changed. We still would like to encourage folks who are not decided going for a master's or PhD program to decide to go into a master's and PhD program. This is, in my opinion, the right thing to do from a society point of view. We don't have enough STEM researcher, folks who are in mathematics or science or engineering or computer science, and this idea or mission is to change this with the RUs, and we are just continuing exactly this mission. I don't want to go away from this mission.